And with that, ladies and gentlemen, it's time now for the very significant inaugural address. So let's not hold those applauses. Allow me to welcome Sri Ravi Shankar Prasad, Honorable Minister for Electronics and IT, Law and Justice, Government of India. Very warm welcome to you, sir.
My very distinguished colleague in the Council of Ministers, Alphonse, Mr. Ajay Sahni, the distinguished secretary of the department, Dr. Ajay Kumar, Gulshan Roy, Sanjay, and Mr. Edward France, distinguished delegate from abroad, ladies and gentlemen, a very warm welcome to all of you. And Gulshan, thank you for recalling all my past association, which I didn't remember. You made me nostalgic. For Sanjay, you remember my relationship with certain predates my becoming minister of your department. That's what stands confirmed today. You know, why this conference today is very significant, being held in India. Asia-Pacific comprises 21 nations. The delegations are present here. These nations range from those countries which are very powerful digitally, and those countries which are beginners. Therefore, it becomes a great occasion of sharing of best practices, knowing the challenges, understanding the opportunities. How I see the present emerging world, ladies and gentlemen, you needed roads for development. You needed healthcare for development. You needed education for development. You needed energy for development of a society. Today, you need internet and digital platform for development of a society and country. It is no more a luxury, but a necessity. That's the first thing we need to understand. I have been saying on many international platforms, and I need to repeat today before this Asia-Pacific congregation, that internet, being one of the finest creations of human mind, cannot remain the monopoly of few. It becomes the ownership of the entire humankind. The first thing I have been articulating. The second is, internet, being a global medium, must have linkage with the local. Local ideas, local culture, local aspirations. And the third is, that is very significant, if internet is to become the medium for human development, it must be safe and secure. And therefore, we consciously and deliberately, and Gulshan was present with me in those deliberations, and so was Dr. Ajay Kumar from Marrakesh to Argentina. We consciously advocated for the multi-stakeholder model. Why? Because in the growth of internet, the government, the academia, the scientific community, the industry, and the civil society all have played a part. And therefore, all need to have a stake. But we have also insisted very clearly and categorically that a state, being the primary custodian of the safety and security of the people, must have a crucial role. And therefore, certain becomes very important. As I say, or it is often said, internet is a virtual world, which does not admit of any geographical boundary or physical boundary. But the problem of the virtual world is felt in the real world. And this conflict keeps on rising and rising. What is our experience in India? Under the dynamic leadership of Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi, we feel digital platform is no more a luxury. And as was said by Shri Ajay Sahni, we are seeking to transform India, not only transforming India, but transforming Indians. We seek to empower ordinary Indians with the power of technology. And therefore, to my guests who have come from abroad, let me outline. We have fixed certain premises for us. One, digital endeavor must lead to digital inclusion. It must empower the ordinary people, regardless of their affluence, wealth, or education. The second, very important, the technology must be affordable, must be developmental, and must be inclusive. My distinguished Minister of State, in his very eloquent style, talked about Aadhaar. Why Aadhaar is important? It is completely safe and secure. It is a low-cost technology, just $1 each. We do 60 million authentication every day to confirm the biometrics and the iris. And all this authentication is nearly free of cost. From digital delivery of services to others, you know why we are doing so. The second fundamental postulates of India's digital story is banking the unbanked, funding the unfunded, securing the unsecured, taxing the untaxed, and the most important, giving a voice to those who are unheard. And in all this, we are using digital technology in a very substantive way. As Alphonse rightly stated, opening almost 30 million bank accounts, 300 million bank accounts, was a Guinness World of Record. To whom? Who had no access to bank accounts. And what we started doing, by seeding their Aadhaar, their mobile phone, and their bank account, we started sending welfare measures directly to the bank account. Today you have seen the result. Nearly $8 billion have been saved, 57,000 crores, which is to be pocketed by middlemen and fictitious claimants. Securing the unsecured, 120 million poor people have been given insurance in accident and also natural, and pension by using digital technology. Funding the unfunded, nearly 80 million Indians have benefited huge amount of money, almost 4 lakh crore. How much it converts into dollar, I'll have to ask Mr. Ajay Sahne if you can quickly count it. And ultimately, who are those? The small people doing a small kiosk on a footpath who had no access to bank or funding. Today, funding has been done, all using digital technology. GST, one country, one tax. Today, the entire GST is digital, being maintained. Giving voice to the unheard, MyGov. Today, almost 4.5 million Indians interact with the Prime Minister, occasionally with me, give their ideas as to how the country should develop. And this I'm not counting the millions on social media. Today, India is home to the biggest footprint of Facebook. The international delegates need to know. WhatsApp download is the highest in the world. Android app download is the highest in the world. Twitter, LinkedIn, all these are having a big footprint in India. Why? This brings me to my other point. India is not only a country of 1.3 billion people. But India is a country where people love technology, enjoy technology. And India is a country which offers a big digital market. All the three are working together. And what we are seeking to convey to the world is that even ordinary technology meant for ordinary people can lead to good digital business and digital economy. That is the whole ecosystem on which we are seeking to work. Therefore, I always say India's digital story when will be fully realized, is going to become a game changer in the quest of digital discourse of the world. Digital India, Make in India, Startup India, Skill India, Smart Cities are all transformative programs designed to empower India and Indians and offer vast opportunity. Digital payment, both the Ajays talked about that. Now this digital payment again is a low-cost technology, Beam app. It was, I was told, 11 million in August. Now the download is 77 million. And today, all the players of the world are on Beam app, from Google to other, to UPIs. Again, in low-cost technology. And India is the only country, ladies and gentlemen, where you need not have a bank account. Even without a bank account, you can be digitally paid and transact, only by using your thumb impression. And as our Prime Minister has stated, in the Indian tradition, thumb used to become the sign of your mental weakness, which you used to call angutha chap. Okay? But by digital technology, we have made thumb as the embodiment of digital empowerment. This is how we are seeking to transform. That being the case, obviously, there will be challenges. But I have a very common sense reply to the whole challenge in the field of cyberspace. We are making information highways, as in the previous government headed by Shri Atal Bihari Vajpayee, which Gulshan was referring to, we made national highways. But if you drive on the national highway, occasionally you commit accident also. People get killed. But that doesn't mean you should stop making national highways. The idea is take precautions, don't drive drunk, maintain the speed limit, have the seat belt on. I think certain is a body which consciously tells the people of India and the world, please drive digital on the digital highway, but have the seat belt on. If that common sense approach is initiated, I see lesser possibility and apprehensions of accident. And what we have done, I wish to congratulate certain Sanjay and his team, and also the predecessor, even Gulshan Roy, that they have developed low-cost technologies. This botnet cleaning is what? If there is a virus in your system, you please download botnet and it will clean the system. That is how we are coming with new products. We have about 200 nearly plus Internet of Things, new devices coming out. Gulshan talked about machine learning, artificial intelligence. We are setting up new centers of excellence. And India has a very abiding concern for new technology and innovation. I will talk about data subsequently because I know the international crowd must know India's stand on data. But what is important is we are encouraging innovation in a very, very substantial way. Government and non-government. We have mandated all the banks must have proper security auditors. We have mandated in all the departments that every department must have a proper cyber security auditor. We are undertaking training of human resource in a very, very big way. 100,000s are being trained. Then drills for judges, drills for civil service, drills for bureaucrats, short courses for bankers. Therefore, the entire infrastructure for creating of cyber security is being encouraged and will continue to be encouraged. And therefore, when I was talking to my department, I decided that we need to do two things. A, we must encourage more and more research in cyberspace. And today I have to make an announcement that we have a very good program of PhD in electronics, whereby we create good human resource for research in electronics. And as you know, India is emerging as a big hub of electronic manufacturing, which we are encouraging. In the last 3 years, only 105 mobile manufacturing factories have come in India, which used to be only two when our government has come to power. Defense electronics, medical electronics, energy electronics, automobile electronics, we are encouraging that. Today I have to announce that the government of India will promote good PhD research in cybersecurity of intending students from the the countries of Asia Pacific. We'll be funding them and also encouraging them to good cybersecurity research, so that they become great contributor in the quest of further cybersecurity. What is the second announcement I have to make? My department is just in the process of working with the Data Security Council of India. A 5 crore grant for startups. And that grant will be for those startups which come with new solutions in the field of cybersecurity. Cybersecurity, you know, is a big emerging area. India's digital economy is on the highway of a great growth. And my department has taken a commitment, we're working together with stakeholders, that we will make India's digital economy a $1 trillion economy in the coming 5 to 7 years. When I talk of digital economy, I mean communication, I mean IT and IT-enabled services, I mean e-commerce, I mean cybersecurity, I mean digital payment, I mean electronic manufacturing. All these are working together. Do you know India is becoming the third biggest startup movement of the world? We are adding 3-4 startups every day. Therefore, all this is being done to ensure the digital space is safe and secure. And therefore, we have taken also a decision that India is becoming a great center of low-cost cybersecurity products. And we are going to give preference to that in the preferential access system of the government. Cybersecurity products being produced in India will be given preference in procurement of cybersecurity products, I want to announce. The last is the issue of data. Obviously, data is important. Mr. Iwan talked about that. Gulshan Rai talked about that. We believe that digital platform will generate tremendous data, extraordinary size and potential. Data is important. But remember, our view is very clear and categorical. And here I can use my responsibility as the Law and Justice Minister of India. The Supreme Court has also given, in its famous finding of nine judges, that innovation is integral to digital technology. And under the garb of privacy, innovation should not be killed. And as the minister of this department, I am equally keen that the great innovative spirit of India in the quest of data analysis should be encouraged. That is one basic observations, fundamental observation I'd like to make. What is the second thing is? India is a democracy governed by rule of law. We respect India, their right, and Indians, their right to convey their views and also their right of privacy. But this has to work in a proper framework. And what is that framework? The framework is data availability, data utility, data innovation, data anonymity, and data privacy. Let me repeat for my delegates who have come from abroad. Data availability, data utility, data innovation, data anonymity, and data privacy. In the government, we want to frame policy as to why in a particular area, a particular illness is there. The government needs data. Their physical being, economic being, geographical problem, soil condition. But that data has to be anonymous. We should not expose the name of the patient. Therefore, anonymity is important. Today, so much of data is being encouraged. Should we stop using mobile phones? Should we stop using internet? At some and my distinguished MOS, in his inimitable style, made a very interesting comment. You want to go to Mumbai, or you want to go to New York, or you want to go to London, you would take a ticket with a digital ticket. The day you are taking a flight, You'll be scanned at the airport, and the CCTV will have your photograph. Therefore, wittingly or unwittingly, the digital technology which is facilitating your travel is also capturing your footprints. Now you can say, I will not go to London. I will not go to New York. Then take a boat and sail to New York and London if you don't want your footprint to be there. Therefore, this whole debate has to be a little rational debate. This whole debate has to be a little mature debate, with greatest of respect. And some of my friends who talk of privacy are those who have been the biggest supporters of right to information, RTI. For the first time, I'm conveying my views in a public platform on the issue of data. But we are committed to have a balance of data availability, data innovation, and also data privacy. And therefore, we have set up a committee under leadership of a great jurist, Justice Sri Krishna, which is working out this whole modality. Mr. Ajay Sahni, Dr. Ajay Kumar, I think Gulshan, you are also a member of that.
Yes, sir.
Gulshan Kumar is a member of that. Many scientists are there. And we are going to come with a very robust data protection law, which will become a great beacon for the rest of the world and also enable certain to work with that. I think these are, ladies and gentlemen, the basic contours of India's digital story. I thought I must share with you that because many of my friends have come from abroad. India's story is a story of inclusion. India's digital story is one of empowerment. And India's digital story is one of equity. This empowering, equity, and transformational. This has to be safe and secure. And I'm quite sure the interactions which has happened and which is going to happen is going to give us a good guidance for future. I'm thankful to Mr. Edward for appreciating India, awarding certain. Sanjay, a heavy responsibility now devolves on you and your team. Keep it up. Good luck. Thank you. Namaskar. Jai Hind.
Thank you very much, sir.